Yeah. Good evening. In the back, can y'all hear? Can you hear a little more volume? All right, we're going to give us 2 seconds. We'll get some. We need you to be removed. All right, that's good. Okay, thank y'all for coming out tonight for our last debate with the sheriff contest. And so we appreciate everyone. We've got a packed house here. And thank you for those who were able to attend the coroner's debate earlier this afternoon, as well as the county commission debate last week, and the Board of Education debate on Monday night. The party really believes that this is a great opportunity for the candidates to get out and meet the citizens of Forsyth County, as well as the citizens of Forsyth County, to hear the candidates on where they stand on their values and their issues of being an elected official for us. I've gone over the rules with the candidates, but I will go over the rules with you because we have some new faces in the crowd, so everybody understands what is going on. Each candidate has a 2-minute opening statement as well as a 2-minute closing statement. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to answer each question and 1 minute for rebuttal. And then each candidate will also be allowed to ask the opponent a question, and then that opponent has 2 minutes to answer that question. We have a great moderator tonight, B.J. Van Gundy. B.J. is the former chair of the Gwinnett Republican Party, former district chair, and as well as former vice chair of the state Georgia Republican Party, and is a delegate to the national convention this year, along with Carolyn Hall Fisher, who is in our first vice chair of the Forsyth County Republican Party. So we got a lot of great people in the room that are doing good things for the Republican parties. With that, I'm going to turn it over to our moderator, B.J. Van Gundy, to get the debate going.
Thank you all. I'm sad to see such a horrible turnout tonight. I was told this might happen. I'm up here from Peachtree Corners in Gwinnett, and I've already cleared it with these guys and the coroner that I'm allowed to cross county lines. So I just wanted to let you all know not to report me to anybody. We'll do the 2-minute, 1-minute rebuttal, but right now we'll have opening statements. And Sheriff, I believe you chose to do your opening statement first.
I did. Quite a crowd tonight. Glad to see you all here. Thank you first to the Republican Party for hosting these debates, and thank you all for your interest in the sheriff's race. My name is Duane Piper, and I'm here tonight to ask you for your vote in the Forsyth County Sheriff primary on May 24th. Took office as your sheriff 3.5 years ago. It's been a very busy 3.5 years and a very successful 3.5 years. We opened 2 new buildings. You may have noticed them on the way in. They're huge. And staffed them. At the same time, we reformed and restructured the entire sheriff's office. We did this with 2 things in mind. First was to make sure that we are protecting the lives and property of the citizens of Forsyth County. And secondly, that we're positioned for going forward as our population continues to grow, that we're at least as successful as we are right now. And we're very successful right now. We enjoy the lowest crime rate in Metro Atlanta. Going forward, we've got new technology coming on board. Right now, Forsyth County is operating way behind about 1990 levels technologically. Starting implementation on that in June. And I'm probably most excited about the working relationship with the school system that we have, the programs that we're working on in collaboration with them. So I won't take up any more time. Thank you all for being here tonight.
Well, I'll say good evening as well, and wow, what a crowd. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being involved in our community. And again, I'd like to say thank you to the Republican Party for hosting this debate tonight. Now, I'm Ron Freeman, and I've lived here in Forsyth County almost my entire life. I graduated from Forsyth County High School, and it was there that I met my wife, Dana, some 29 years ago. Now, folks, I'm a third-generation police officer, and service in our community runs very deep in my family. I worked for the Forsyth County Sheriff's Office for over 25 years. I served as your chief of detectives, and I also served as a South Precinct Commander. Now, in 2013, I left, and I went to Brookhaven. I was selected as the deputy chief, and I helped open Brookhaven in the newest city in the state of Georgia, and I helped build that police department from the ground up. I'll tell you just a little bit about myself. I'm a graduate of the FBI National Academy, and I was later privileged to serve as the president of that organization. Now, I knew if I was going to be successful in a law enforcement career, it's a profession that I was going to have to put in a lot of hard work and hours for my education and my training. I did that while I was raising a family, while I was working full-time. I completed 3 college degrees. At the same time, I completed the Georgia Law Enforcement Command College, the FBI Law Enforcement Executive Development School, and as part of that, I was privileged to travel all over this country. I've seen some of the best police departments all across this nation. I've seen some of the best programs, and I will tell you that it's important for you leader to have a broad definition of what best practices in law enforcement are in the country. Now, I was willing to put in that hard work, those long hours and that time, prepare myself to lead an agency. Folks, make no mistake, there's no shortcut to that. There's just not one. Now, while doing this, I still served right here in my community, our church. I served in nonprofit boards. I served as a drug education teacher. I served as a youth football coach, softball coach. It's just what you do. You get involved in the community, you get back. Now, I'll tell you that Forsyth County is at a pivotal point. The sheriff's office is at a pivotal point right now. We can't operate in the past with old techniques. Politics has no place in law enforcement agency. And I believe that you as citizens deserve full transparency. I think you expect full transparency. A leader who will deliver what they promise. A leader who will under-promise and over-deliver and will do what they say. They'll tell you the truth, good or bad, regardless of the consequences. Now, I'm Ron Freeman, and I'm here tonight to ask for your support to be your next sheriff in Forsyth County.
All right, thank you. A little bit of clapping is okay, but let's not get crazy. Okay. All right. Now, the question's going to come back to you, and gentlemen, I'm going to go on a first name basis with you guys. So, just Ron and Duane, right?
Please.
So, Duane, the first question then comes to you, is why should the taxpayers of Forsyth County feel confident that we will responsibly and effectively allocate the sheriff's department budgeted funds?
As I mentioned earlier, the success we've had in the first 3.5 years. I forgot to mention in my opening statements that we're under budget every year, have been every year. First year's budget was $4.1 million under the 2012 budget. Second year, we're still $3.1 million under budget. And last year, we were a little under $1 million under budget. This year, after fully staffing the 2 new buildings that I pointed out, we're scheduled to be almost dollar for dollar what the 2012 budget was. I still think we can come under that. The key to it is the restructuring. We're way heavy on middle management. Still have some. We're built for the future. But middle management is taking up money and affecting communications and actually affecting law enforcement. We had a very fragmented agency, a bunch of specialties that worked and only did what their specialty was. And when we had deputies that went to see the public, they had to wait for somebody else. We're working very hard to change that, and the budget goes down with that.
Thank you, Duane. And Ron?
Well, we might as well start it now. So let's put it this way. Politicians like to spend budgets. And folks, that's spin. George Bush called that fuzzy math. And I'm going to tell you right now, that's fuzzy math. Let's make this clear. This is an attempt to make all this look good. They're not under budget. If you're going to compare apples to apples, the 2012 budget to the 2015, the most recent completed year budget, it's up $6 million. Yes, the county changed the way that they do their accounting. Yes, they changed something called internal service charges. But the bottom line is the money being spent to operate and run the sheriff's office from the county taxpayers, not just the sheriff's office budget, but from the county, is up significantly. You remember that my opponent campaigned in 2012, he was going to cut the budget $5 million. It's up $6 million from 2012. Now, this agency's operated with a lot of vacancies over the last 2 or 3 years. In 2015, the vacant positions that were funded by the Board of Commissioners accounted for $3.8 million annually for that year in unused salary, wages, and benefits. So I'm very glad that we gave back $1 million, but there was $3.8 in unused salary. Now, we've wasted money on luxury trucks. We haven't used state contract pricing. And folks, it's time to quit spending this. Tell the truth about where our budget is, where your taxpayer dollars are going. And I'll tell you that I'm going to be different. How am I going to be different? I'll publish a spending report online every month to show you every dollar we spend at the sheriff's office. It's what you deserve. I think it's what you expect. And I will tell you that it's time to be honest about what we're spending your tax dollars on. Thank you.
I'm not sure what numbers you're talking about. I am aware that in 2010 there were some charter changes made to how the commission applies internal service fees. Not sure how much they've changed or what they've changed in the last few years, but what I'm going by is actual budgets from 2012, which was $38,226,049. 2013, my first year in office, was $34,170,551. 2014, $35,094,077. 2015, it's just gotten completed, $37,487,071. That is including internal service fees. I'm not sure whose math is fuzzy, but these are numbers from the county commission.
Ron, I'm going to let you have 30 seconds to answer his question to you.
Duane, I will tell you that this comes from the county as well, and it shows in 2012 the internal service charges were $4.66 million. And in 2016, your adopted budget only had $763,000. That's a $4 million difference. The county's still paying for it. They're paying for those things, but it's not in your budget. That's what it costs to run the sheriff's office. So let's quit saying what your budget is, and let's talk about what it actually costs to run the sheriff's office. Thank you.
All right, and now we'll move in. We'll stay with the budget right now. The current budget allocation, as I have it here, and I expect it's accurate because there were brilliant people putting these questions together. Because they also brilliantly asked me to do this. So I've got a budget here, a 2016 budget of $38,348,900. So about $38 million. The question is how do you plan on allocating it, and or do you plan on cutting or reducing the budget allocated as it is right now to the sheriff's department? If so, where do you propose to reduce expenses, if you propose to reduce expenses? And Ron, you start this one.
Okay, thank you. I think the first place that you start reducing your budget is you buy things on state contract and you don't waste money. You don't buy toys. You don't buy $60,000 race trucks. You don't buy $250,000 worth of boats. You take state contracts. I know, I just built a police department on a budget. In Brookhaven, they gave me 3.5 months to go from ground zero to have a police department running on the street with about 70 employees. Trust me, I had to do a lot of penny pinching when I did that. I bought things on state contract. I don't understand how we go and buy cars that are $38,000, $40,000, $50,000, $60,000 when they're $22,000 and $23,000 on state contract. That's the first place that you take money and you save money. The second place is, and I was successful in Brookhaven doing this as well, is we start looking towards retired officers and part-time officers. I can hire two part-time officers to do certain functions within the sheriff's office, let's say court security or maybe civil or some other functions within the sheriff's office, get more hours from them, and actually pay about 40% less than it takes to do a full-time officer. It's basic business, and you need the education and the background to understand how to operate a business. I've ran multi-million dollar budgets. I created from the ground up a $7.5 million budget. I understand what it takes to be fiscally responsible and fiscally accountable to our taxpayers. And the one thing that you will have for me that makes it really simple, I'll show you exactly where I'm spending your tax dollars. And if you want to hold me accountable, look at it online and call me up and say, Ron, why are you spending money on this? We've got a lot of programs that we need to fund. Drug education and drug eradication are two of the places we're going to have to spend money, but we can look at other overfunded places that we can use that for. I do not think we're going to have to raise the budget in any way, shape, or form.
Okay, and Duane?
Repeat the question, I kind of lost track.
Well, it's the budget as allocated according to these numbers for 2016 is $38,348,000. And the question was how do you plan on allocating that and continuing on with it this year? And do you plan at all to cut or reduce the budget and or change allocations in any way?
The internal service fees, some of what I was talking about before, we've managed to get some of our cuts, a lot of our cuts, have been in internal service fees. He's talking about state pricing. Tires is the first thing that comes to my mind. We go through a lot of them. We drive hundreds of thousands of miles, and tires become a big expense. We've changed, one of the ways we cut already, is we changed how and where we buy our tires. The county's fleet budget, fleet maintenance, with buying the tires and then adding on a 20% premium and then installation fees. We've gone to the source, we buy them from there, it's been quite a reduction in cost. But as far as we went into about four different things there, any specialty vehicles, any boats, anything that we buy, don't come out of taxpayers' pockets. They come from drug seizure funds, and some of them we may or may not budget for, but everything we bought has been necessary to provide the service, level service to go along with the safety in our county. If I'm not mistaken, one of my opponent's chief campaign promises was to add about another 20 or 30 deputies to go into schools. That is the biggest cost in law enforcement, and really the only cost that the sheriff can control is how many deputies it takes to do the job. Anything other than that amounts to $3 or $4 million. That's what the main cost is, and I don't understand how my opponent thinks he's going to cut with adding more deputies.
Okay, Ron, 1 minute.
Okay, thank you. How do I cut without adding more deputies? We've ran as many as 80 vacancies. You're still running vacancies in the office. Year over year, we've had vacant positions that you, the taxpayers, have funded. The money has sat there. You paid for officers that you did not get on the street. Where did the money go? It didn't come back to you. So where am I going to come up with these officers? I'm going to hire part-times, and I'm going to get extra hours for less money. I'm going to fill some of the vacant positions that you as taxpayers have already funded. Talk about where we can cut things and where we do things. My opponent has created his own purchasing department within the sheriff's office, his own personnel unit within the sheriff's office. He's added administrative personnel. Folks, that was provided by the county at no additional charge to the sheriff's office. We're adding people that do not affect your safety and your kids' safety on the street. I can change that. I can put an officer at every school, and I can do it without raising the budget.
Duane, 30 seconds.
My opponent just said two different things. First, he said that I've been over budget, but then he said that the money that I go under budget doesn't go back to the taxpayers. I'm not sure where the money goes when I go under budget, but it certainly must go back to the taxpayers. That's about all I cover.
I take care of a little housekeeping thing. There's a lot of people out in the vestibule out there. There are seats up here, y'all, that are in the aquarium out there, if you'd like to come on in. And any of y'all standing in the back, there's seats over here and here. If you'd like to move in, go ahead and come on in. I hate seeing open seats and have people standing in the back. You wouldn't want to do it at church. Why do it here? All right. We'll now move out of some administrative issues and move into some policy type questions. According to a study conducted by UGA in 2013, so this is a few years old, there were 935 reported cases of child abuse in Forsyth County, yet only 22% or 211 of those reported cases were investigated. What can be done to improve the percentage of investigations performed, and what could be the reason that investigations may be down like that? you first, Duane. Yes, sir.
Communication and getting rid of the fragmentation, that's part of what I was talking about when I first opened my statements. Traditionally, the Forsyth County Sheriff's Office has operated the way law enforcement has always operated. They created command, and under there, they staffed it. People had different areas, had different specialties, and that's all they did. What we're working on now, we started when I first took office, was that everybody knows what to do to help the public when they come to help them, when they're called. A lot of them, I think, probably and historically, had just slipped through the cracks, weren't properly reported. I'm not sure where UGA got the numbers from, but diversifying our agency. And I just brainlocked on that one, so that'll go on rebuttal.
And as I stated, this was from a study done in 2013, so I expect that those numbers are from 2011, 2012. I'll just stay with you, Sheriff. Have the numbers improved since then? Are there more investigations being performed at this time than back then?
I didn't know about those numbers, so I don't know if we've gone up or not.
Okay. Ron?
Yeah. In 2001, when I was your chief of detectives here, I, along with other folks and who worked very hard, we created the Special Victims Unit. When I took over investigations, the first thing I did when I took command of that unit is I looked and I said, wow, we've got people who are not specializing in the ability to do certain very complex and very sensitive crimes. And some of those things are child molestation. So we picked people who had a servant heart. We picked people who had the empathy to understand and deal with those families. And we sent them to a whole lot of specialized training so they could work those cases, and those families did not fall through the cracks. And in fact, from 2001 to 2005, that Special Victims Unit did phenomenal work. We created multidiscipline teams. We worked with the prosecutors. We worked with advocacy centers. We quit police officers, the big guy police officer trying to interview a four-year-old kid. We had disciplinary teams, and we had counselors who would interview these kids who knew how to do it and solicit honest and open information. That's what it takes. It's great to diversify. I agree with my opponent. Our officers should be diversified. But if you think every officer can work a child molestation case, you ought to try working one. I have, and they cannot do it. You want someone who can specialize in those kind of cases.
I must have misspoke if my opponent thought that I said we've done away with the specialization. Those types of investigations can't be done without that specialization. We still have the same relationship with the CAC, Child Advocacy Center. We still have the same specialists, possibly more. I don't know the numbers from 2001 through 2005, but we still have that specialization. The difference comes in, and when my opponent was the commander of the South Precinct, and some of y'all sitting out there will remember this, the deputies that work in uniform, the ones that you see the most of, were prevented and not even allowed to make arrests if they had evidence right there in front of them. That's what I'm talking about. When there's arrests to be made, when your evidence is right in front of you, they were not allowed to even do their jobs. That's the segmentation that I'm talking about, the fragmentation of the agency. The agency has to work together as a whole.
I'm aware of the position of my sheriff in Gwinnett County. He and I are very good friends, but I'm not, and I'm going to take a point of personal privilege and add a question to this list that I came up with while I was sitting here. I was listening very closely to you guys, but I came up with another question. And my question is, like I said, I know where my sheriff is, I know where Warren is over in Cobb County on this, but I'm curious, what is your position on personal concealed carry or open carry by citizens of Forsyth County? And Ron, you're first on this one.
That was the best softball question you could ever throw at me.
I had no idea.
I am one of the most proactive Second Amendment supporters you will ever find. In fact, I will tell you that I've been a firearms instructor for over 25 years. I have taught literally thousands of police officers and thousands of citizens gun safety, gun handling, how to shoot, and almost as importantly, how you can legally apply those things on the street to protect yourself and your family. I had somebody ask me in this campaign, I heard you weren't pro-gun, right? Well, four of our fundraisers have been a sporting shoot event and advanced handgun classes for citizens as fundraisers. If that doesn't tell you where I stand on concealed carry, open carry, and citizens' right to carry guns, then I don't know what does. I absolutely wish anyone who has the right mindset, I always advocate training, I wish people would go get training, but if you are of the right mindset to carry a gun to help protect your community and protect your family, God bless you. I wish more wit and criminals were scared of you.
And Sheriff, same question, sir.
Mine's much shorter. If you don't have a gun, please get one. I've got some extras if you want to borrow one until you do. But please know how to use it. You endangered yourself and everybody else if you don't know how to use it.
All right, we're going to move into the, drugs. Do you agree or disagree with President Obama's administration? And man, since that was such a softball question to both of you, I'm just going to go back to Ron for the first one here. Do you agree or disagree with President Obama's administration's proposal to declassify marijuana as a Schedule I drug?
I make no bones about my belief that marijuana, alcohol, and tobacco are gateway drugs to our kids. And I will not support the legalization of marijuana or the declassification of marijuana from a criminal offense. Does that mean that I believe kids should be criminalized because they get caught with a little bit of marijuana? Absolutely not. But to decriminalize and take it away from that, folks, I have a friend who's a sheriff in Larimer County, Colorado. That's Fort Collins, where the University of Colorado is. He and I are both graduates of the FBI Academy. He and I have had long conversations about what has happened to the state of Colorado since the legalization of marijuana. We have the third highest OD death rate in the state of Georgia in Forsyth County. Drug use is through the roof. We have way too few narcotics officers working. Two, no, I am not for declassifying or decriminalizing in any way marijuana.
No, I'm not for decriminalizing marijuana. I'm not for decriminalizing any type of drug. I think we need to pay a little bit of attention to alcohol also, which we have been doing. We've stepped up probably 20 or 30 fold our enforcement of underage alcohol sales. I take a couple of exceptions there. Third highest overdose rate in the state of Georgia. I'd like to know where those numbers came from. Look them up, that's good. I lost the rest of it.
He mentioned two narcotic officers.
Sometimes when you hear such a whopper, you just don't even know where to start with it. We actually have six narcotics officers operating inside the county right now, with two additional, one assigned to HIDA, which is high intensity drug area, and the DEA. We get in a lot of information from the federal, being attached to the federal task forces on drugs that are coming into our community. Forsyth County has long had a drug problem. In the mid-2000s, over our narcotics unit, we seized over half a ton of cocaine right here in Forsyth County in 2007. Nobody knew about it. Education and awareness is key to keeping our kids off of drugs. In 2013, that's why we started talking about that we do have a drug problem in Forsyth County. We quit denying it. We quit hiding from it. There are drugs in Forsyth County. There have been drugs in Forsyth County. If you don't tell people about it, you can't get them to not do it. The education, again, with the schools. CHAMPS program, which was discontinued when my opponent was on command staff. They took the drug education out of the schools. With collaboration with the schools, we've put the CHAMPS program back in, which is a program that helps kids make good, positive choices and find other alternatives rather than using drugs for their problems.
Back to you for 1 minute.
Okay. And again, I don't know where your numbers are, but this is your criminal investigations roster from Monday. Narcotics, two. Folks, we have two people working narcotics in Forsyth County. You can say people are working dual roles. Two people cannot work narcotics. You should know you were a narcotics supervisor when you were working for me. Folks, and I mean as a shot. Folks, you cannot work narcotics in this county with two people. We have to get very serious. I agree with my point. We have to get serious about education for our children, serious about trying to prevent addiction, but by gosh, we better do something about stemming the flow of drugs coming into Forsyth County. And I will do that because I will take some of these overinflated agencies, I'm sorry, overinflated units, and I will put them on narcotics.
We're back to the sheriff now, and we're going to stay on the subject just a bit more. Duane, I'm going to stay on this with a... both of y'all mentioned continuing to do more to do it, but I'm going to ask you to be more specific. Specifically, how do you plan without giving away the secrets to the bad guys? Don't tell them where you're hiding. But specifically, how do you plan to alleviate the distribution and trafficking of illegal drugs? How can we know that under you that distribution and trafficking will go down, regardless of the fact that the population is going up and there's just more and more of it around? How can we as citizens that live here in Forsyth County know that drug trafficking and distribution is going to go down?
And we're not going to. Some of the deputies that work narcotics investigations specifically, make sure we understand what we're talking about. Narcotics with background investigations can't be worked with two. That's why we've got six doing it. We've tried to explain to Mr. Freeman this agency is not the one that he left. He can't seem to grasp that it's changed. But even with the six that we have working it, you can't possibly work narcotics in a county with 225,000 people. You have to have hundreds of people working narcotics. Some of our best narcotics officers are working the streets in uniform, and they are actually carrying on investigations, some of them right this second while we're talking. Won't give away the methods. But as a law enforcement agency, if we don't stay dynamic, if we don't understand how the narcotics are being distributed, if we don't stay not up with it, but ahead of it, there's no way we can cut it down. That's why some of our best ones are out there working on the streets, constant communication with the six that are running background investigations, which is all that is for longer term investigations. The rest of them have to be out there where the public is. The public has never been protected from the inside of a building, from having an office someplace. It happens out there where the public is and where the public is at risk.
Do you know the question? Okay, then I'll not have to repeat it. Go.
So yes, we can do more, and yes, we have to do more. Our kids and our families demand that we do more. Background investigations, two people working narcotics. I'm looking at the roster. It's your roster for Monday. The rest of them are listed under property and other things. Folks, it does take more than two people to work narcotics. And it does take people who can do undercover investigations and people who can work with and have relationships with our surrounding counties. If you think the drug dealer that is selling drugs to our kids is not doing the same thing in Alpharetta, is not doing the same thing in Johns Creek and Sandy Springs and Roswell, then we're missing the boat. We need to have a close working relationship with those agencies. I have close working relationships with those agencies. I have a tremendous network. Every one of those chiefs I just mentioned, I have a working relationship with. I'm not saying that Forsyth County doesn't. They know me, they trust me. It takes all of us working together, sharing information. It takes officers who are willing to go out in the middle of the night when we catch somebody with drugs in their car and have a conversation with them to see if we can get some more information that's going to lead to the drug dealer. Again, I'm not interested in criminalizing kids, but I sure do want to get the guys that are bringing heroin to our kids and the people that are selling drugs to our kids. And you better put more people in it, and you better get them out there talking and doing the investigations. That's what it's going to take. That's what I know how to do, and that's why narcotics reported to me when I was the chief of detectives, and that's why we made those cases.
Your numbers are very suspect. You didn't answer the question. Third highest in heroin overdose numbers in the state.
I'd just like to hear the answer to that.
Ben?
I did not say third highest in heroin overdose, but we are tied with Clayton County for the third highest OD death rate in the state of Georgia. When you take out the four metro counties that have their own, these are GBI statistics, they came from the GBI. When you take out the four metro counties that have their own medical examiner, which is Fulton, Cobb, Gwinnett, and DeKalb, think of the size of those. We are tied with Clayton County. Folks, do you want to be tied with anything, much less death of our kids and our own citizens, with anything with Clayton County? That's where we're at, 28 last year in Forsyth County. We were both at the drug summit, we watched it roll across the screen. It is not heroin that I said. We're not tied for third in heroin, but I'm scared we're headed that way. And I'm not willing to let my Forsyth County let that happen to it.
Okay, back to you.
Just to recap, so we're third highest, except for the others that are higher than that. I just recap on that.
Okay. Let's see. We're going to move into with the, and who's going first this time? This is me. How about you? I'll let Duane go first. Go answer. Oh, I didn't give you a question. That was a trick. With the rise of school-related violence and shooting across the country, how do you plan to keep the schools and children of Forsyth County safe?
The same way we keep the rest of the community safe. The danger, I don't know if any of y'all saw the school system. I wasn't even aware of this, but their survey on school, on student health and safety, our school system enjoys about the same level of crime that the rest of our community has, which is to say, not much. That's through, again, a collaborative effort. The educational things that we're working on with the school, in addition to CHAMPS program, is something called Seven Mindsets. We spent quite a bit of narcotic seizure money on that. These are educational tools that teach children positive decision-making skills and teaches them other ways than violence, drugs, and alcohol to deal with the problems that come up on them. Nobody in the world has ever started taking drugs by walking down the street and drugs jump up on them and they start doing drugs. There's something that drives them there, and the key to all of that is communication with the children, reinforcing what they learn at home so they learn the same things in the schools so they make better choices and they don't even start down that way.
Okay, thank you. Ron?
Well, folks, I don't have a crystal ball, and I don't know where the next school shooting is going to happen, but I know as your sheriff, it's not going to be in Forsyth County without a deputy at a school. I'm not going to pick and choose who gets protected. It's just not me. Now, folks, I'm from here. I don't know how many of you remember in 1990 a school shooting in South Forsyth. I do because I was there. As a police officer, as a deputy sheriff, I was there. I remember them stopping the FBI Academy in 1999 when I was a student at the FBI Academy, and we all huddled around big screen TVs in the TV rooms watching Columbine. And it changed me. It changed what I believed. It changed who I was and what I believed about school safety. Now, I argued with our previous sheriff. I said we should have more school resource officers. Oh. Sheriff and I had long conversations before about more school resource officers. Folks, there's a lot of conversation right now about the BOE and whether they want an officer at every school. If you elect me as your sheriff, that's going to send a very strong message to an elected board of education of what you want. If you want an officer at every school, send a message. We'll put them there. We won't be disciplinarians, but we will there to keep bad things from happening to your kids, and I agree with my opponent. We will be there to do everything we can to keep kids from delving into that dangerous world of drugs. Thank you.
Did you have anything to add in? As he alluded to a little bit, he was the commander of the South Precinct at the time that we removed school resource officers and agency. The previous sheriff and his command staff made the decision to remove school resource officers from the schools. That was one of the reasons that I ran for office in the first place. I wouldn't just stand by and watch something like that. There's quite a contrast between my opponent and I. Probably the biggest one is my inability to stand still to see an injustice. It was important enough to me to run for office then. As an agency, had been cut down to 4 school resource officers. I increased it to 16, 14 in the schools with 2 sergeants, without charging the schools another penny. My question to that would be, why is it so important now when it wasn't that important to him when he had a title, he had a comfortable job? Why did he not step out and do something then? I did.
You have 30 seconds to answer the question.
Well, I'll tell you, I was the one on the table screaming and yelling if we cut school resource officers. But at the end of the day, when you work for a sheriff and you're not the sheriff, as you know, the sheriff gets to make that decision. I didn't. You alluded, why didn't I run in 2012? You know, I didn't run because it wasn't the right time for me to run. Because I was dealing with an illness with my daughter. Because my family needed me more than Forsyth County needed me. And I'm here now to fix the things that need to be fixed and protect our county.
Thank you. Both of you have alluded to working more closely with the community, and that you know you have your officers, but I would suggest that I think you'd agree that it's helpful if you have aware citizens, as we talked about citizens that are trained and able to use firearms, but are also aware of things that they can report to you and help you with. So I wanted to ask you what kind of efforts over the next 4 years could the citizens of Forsyth County look forward to in coming out of the sheriff's office in helping to educate the other emergency personnel and the citizens on pressing issues such as drug abuse, domestic violence, child abuse, sexual assault, and something else that I recently attended a class in Gwinnett County, which was an active shooter situation and educating the citizens on what they should do in that case. And Ron, we'll start with you.
Well, that's exactly what I'm talking about, is transparency and letting our citizens know exactly what's going on. Now, I will give the sheriff's office, they have a tremendous Facebook page. Their social media is second to none, unless you really want to know about the crime occurring in Forsyth County. I did the same thing in Brookhaven. We had good social media, and we should be creating positive relationships and positive images of us with the community. It is important, I agree. But by gosh, we should also be telling you about crime and what's occurring in your community. I dare anybody, go back and look at their Facebook page for the last 3 years. Tell me how many times they've told you about a series of car break-ins, a series of burglaries in certain neighborhoods, so you, the citizen, can be aware. Hey, it's real simple. If 20 cars have been broken into my neighborhood, I want to know about it. Why? Because I want to make sure that I help protect myself, and I want you to be able to help protect your community. So will we continue social media? Absolutely we will, but we'll tell you what's going on. We'll also include what we started in Brookhaven, crime mapping. You can go online when you're in Brookhaven, you can put in an address or any address and you can see actually what's going on in the community. In fact, you can even read the police reports or a shortened version of it. We'll put out weekly crime stats. We'll use other types of social media. There's things like Code Red and others. We'll investigate what's best for that. And active shooter training, absolutely we need to continue and do that. That was started by the Federal Bureau of Investigations. They train law enforcement agencies across this nation. They asked us to go out and teach other law enforcement agencies, and then they asked us to start going out and teaching citizens, and we did that. I'm glad to see that the Sheriff's Office started doing that, along with most every other metro agency around this community.
Thank you. Again, I appreciate the compliments. That only started after I took office. The ability to do it was there. It wasn't being used. The communication with the public is key. I'll be checking to see what doesn't make it on the internet or on the Facebook page going forward, but that's one of the main reasons for doing what we do, is so that the public knows what's going on, so you know whether to be alarmed or not alarmed. The technology that we're bringing on board will help make it a lot more accessible and quickly accessible, more widely accessible on the different things that the public can come in and get instantly. You just mentioned something I hadn't thought about in a while, but in 2016, I'm not sure why we're making the public come to us to get records. We can send it to them. The technology we're bringing on board will make it even more effective, but the two-way communication through social media, been extremely effective. Thank you for noticing.
Okay, Brian.
I agree that two-way communication with social media can be highly effective. Unfortunately, we're not having two-way communication right now. We are on road closures. I mean, we're doing some good public service stuff. I'm not saying that we're not. What I'm looking at and what I'm telling you is, you need to know what is going on in your community to help you protect yourselves and your community. You don't get that now. You talk about the new technology that we're bringing on. I happen to know a little bit about it. I implemented that very same technology in Brookhaven. I did it in 6.5 weeks. We're taking a little bit longer than that to do it here. It allows crime mapping, if you want it. I wanted it. I wanted our citizens in Brookhaven. I want our citizens in Forsyth County to know what's going on. But we'll do better than that. We will tell you. We'll put it on social media. We'll put it in Neighborhood Watch. We'll tell you exactly what's going on in your community so that you know how to help protect yourselves and you know how to keep your eyes open to help us protect you. It is a two-way street, but it takes both of us communicating back and forth. And about crime, because it doesn't look good and because it's not good PR, I don't care. I'm going to tell you what you need to know so you can protect your families.
All right, thank you. Make sure both of you are watching the young lady down here with the colored folders. When red pops up, you got about 3 seconds. I don't have one of those cool bells like they had on Fox News, a little doorbell kind of thing, which would be annoying anyway. Let's see. The GBI has been mentioned, and I've got a couple questions here. Is what's your plan to be proactive? And we're going back to Duane now. What is your plan to be proactive in working with the GBI? And then in addition to that, if you could go ahead and answer another question here, that in order to conduct a fair, unbiased investigation relating to internal Forsyth County affairs involving members of the Forsyth County government, I guess other branches of the government, should that investigation be conducted by the GBI in lieu of the Sheriff's Department? So plans to work with the GBI, and then proper requests to the GBI to investigate those things so there's not any appearance of impropriety from it being internally.
You know, we actually enjoy a very good relationship with the GBI. The main function that they serve for us as an agency, because Forsyth County has so many different abilities, that we don't really have to call them in very often. Use of force situations and criminal activity by employees, which luckily we haven't had a whole lot of. But other than that, I don't see increasing the use of them. They actually can't start an investigation here without our request. But really not sure what the question is, other than if you're asking what the rules are. But you know, we have to request them to come in and do an investigation. I don't anticipate calling them in any more often than we do now.
Okay, thank you. Ron?
Well, I happen to enjoy a very good relationship with the senior management of the GBI. We're on a first-name basis. We've worked very closely together in many organizations. And do I see us using the GBI or requesting their assistance? Yeah, I actually do. They're a very well-run organization. Most importantly, they're an independent organization. And the criminal justice process, God forbid if someone's charged with a crime, if somebody in this room were to be charged with a crime, you want there to be absolutely no appearance of impropriety, whether it exists or not. And we should take every precaution to make sure that it doesn't appear to be politically motivated, to have some other issue attached to it. So in a recent case that we saw, folks, if it involves county contracts and it involves agencies that have county contracts, people that maybe hold county positions, and particularly folks who have a complaint against the sheriff's office, I don't want to touch that with a 10-foot pole. I will do everything to make sure that it is investigated properly, and if a criminal action occurs, that it's prosecuted. I'll work hand in hand with the GBI, but I don't want to do anything that will make it harder for our prosecutors to be able to prosecute someone who's violated a law. That's why an independent third party can come in and do those things. Just the same reason we call them in if we have an officer involved shooting or use of force. So there is no potential conflict of interest. We owe that to you as your law enforcement officers, that you give us the power, that you actually tell us we can arrest you. We owe that to you so that you know you can trust us, that everything we're doing is non-biased. Yes, I'll use them, and I'll use them probably more than we are now.
I won't be a full minute, but
okay.
I wasn't aware we were talking about one specific case. I can't think of a circumstance where I would investigate another government body or agency. That would be something that I would call the GBI in. Just because somebody has some connection to the county, I still have responsibilities in this county. I'm still a constitutional officer in this county, and I'm not going to abdicate my responsibilities to somebody else because there's an uncomfortable situation or somebody might think badly of me.
Getting down in the last few minutes, I'll have one more question, then we'll move on to your questions for each other. I'm over here debating myself right now on which question to ask. Yeah, why not? It's something that's been in the news and in the papers regarding the issues of accreditation of the Forsyth County Police or Sheriff's Department, both the CLA LEA accreditation and the state of Georgia accreditation. And I'd like to start with you, Sheriff, if you could address that and what your plans are, or if they're not important, then go ahead and let us know.
Don't have any plans. We've already made the decisions, and this again comes back to some truthfulness issues, I think, by my opponent. If you'll watch the news over the next couple of days, you'll probably see some clarification on the situation. The accusation from my opponent was that we had lost, not voluntarily given up, but lost accreditation from a private company named called Kalia. The actual facts of it are, when I inherited this agency, we had two certifications, accreditations. We had the Kalia accreditation, which is a company run out of Virginia, assessed by people from all over the nation, come in and tell you what you're doing right and wrong with your policies, and they have standards that you meet. We also had a Georgia state certification. It's run by the Georgia Chiefs of Police, and there's also sheriffs sitting on their board. The Georgia certification costs about $500 per year. I just got off the phone with Sheriff Couch from Hall County as I was coming in today, and they actually dropped Kalia about a year before we did, and they had spent $1.7 million on a Kalia accreditation over the previous 7 years. There's also been some agencies that have dropped it behind me. It's a financial decision. The accreditation and the state certification are virtually the same thing. Even the assessors that they use are the same assessors that are used from Georgia for Kalia assessments. That's a financial decision, one of the better financial decisions I've made, actually.
Right, you have 2 minutes.
Folks, Kalia, the National Accreditation of Law Enforcement Agencies, Advanced Accreditation, and Georgia State Certification are not apples and apples. One's a 70% reduction. We spent $100,000, somewhere in that neighborhood, and we failed accreditation. Do you say we didn't fail? It's a blue ribbon seal of approval. It is an independent board coming in and proving to you that your sheriff's office is doing what it says it's going to do. Now, weeks before this came in, before the Kalia team came in to reaccredit for the fourth time the Forsyth County Sheriff's Office, you were quoted in the paper as saying it's a prestigious honor of professionalism. Months later, that drastically has changed. You said for 3 years in annual reports, it's a great thing, I love it, there's nothing wrong with it. And I'm paraphrasing, he did not use those exact words. It's time to be honest. There's 49 agencies in the state of Georgia who have national accreditation. Agencies that surround us. And yeah, you may have talked to Sheriff Couch and he told you he dropped it, but he probably may or may not have told you that one of the main reasons they dropped it because the Kalia manager actually deleted all their files when she got mad because they transferred her and they arrested her for deleting files. So yes, they dropped it because they would have had to start from the ground up. There is professionalism and there's what we say. I had an old coach that said, You know, your talk talks and your walk talks, but nothing talks like your walk talks. And national accreditation is putting our walk with our talk. Just days before, the Attorney General forced you to turn over documents that had things like, we're giving you mercy findings from the CLIA assessors. Just a few weeks ago, we finally get and ask for a national accreditation report that was emailed to you, and your attorney's answer back to the Attorney General, who was telling you to turn it over, was, yeah, we got it, but it's no longer on our files. But my client doesn't use email. If you don't use email, Sheriff Piper, then where's the CLIA report? Who deleted it off your email account when it was sent to you? Because your own attorney said it was sent.
Absolutely correct. Honesty counts, innuendo, and trying to make something look like something is not because you need a job is two completely different things. Can I add that back on in my minute?
Yeah, so you get an extra 15 seconds there.
I think I actually heard an accusation there that Hall County was about to fail it because somebody did something.
If y'all could let him finish, then I won't have to add another 15 seconds and another 15 seconds.
We don't have the time nor the documentation sitting in front of us right this minute to settle this, but I'm fairly confident this is going to be settled in the next few days in the news.
Dang. You can have 15 seconds.
Let me read to you an email from Gary George, the Public Safety Director in Alpharetta, to his internal staff. August 26, 2015, to all. I know you're all hearing about Forsyth County dropping their accreditation process. Sheriff Piper called me 2 to 3 times a Sunday a few weeks ago as they were failing their on-site. He was asking for help. Joe and I did our best to help, but to no avail. I say all this to tell you that CLIA and accreditation is a good thing, and we're staying the course. Don't buy into their story and their attempt to get other agencies to drop the accreditation process. Just remember there's two sides to every story, and somewhere in the middle is the truth. Personally, I believe this is a very foolish move on the part of Forsyth County.
Yeah. We're going to move into questions for each other. Go ahead. You have 15 seconds, Chair.
Mr. George lives in Missouri right now, but he is the man that swore you in as a reserve at Alpharetta. I think that you're supposed to do 20 hours a month down there. You've done a total of 4 hours of reserve duty over 5 or 6 months. I don't doubt that you got Mr. George to write something to help you in your political endeavor.
We'll now move to questions for each other. And Ron, we'll start with you. You have the opportunity to ask a question. Now, keep in mind, a question is usually one sentence. It has a little squiggly thing on the end. And it's a question for the other person to answer. It is not 20 sentences of statement, and then you throw a question on the end, and you just decide to. So please, try and ask a question. Thank you.
I will. It is more than one sentence. So in your 2012 campaign, you promised to publish an annual spending report, create a citizens advisory board, cut the budget by $5 million, use zero-based budgeting, and have purchases with drug seizure funds go through the formal purchasing process. None of those things have happened. Can you tell us why you haven't done that?
You may have to go back to one by one. But first year, $4.1 million.
Annual spending report.
Annual spending report. It is published through the county. Looked at that, and it was not going to be financially feasible to duplicate what the county does.
Said you're going to create a citizens advisory board.
Haven't done that.
You said you're going to cut the budget by $5 million.
I already did that, 4.1.
Okay. You said you're going to use zero-based budgeting.
I actually went to zero-based formation of the entire agency, which cut the budget by $4.1 million in 1 year.
And you said you're going to use drug seizure funds and have them go through the formal purchasing process.
Got no answer for that one.
All right. Duane, you have an opportunity to ask Ron a question.
I don't have one to ask him.
don't have any questions. All right. We'll now move into closing statements. And Sheriff, you're up first for a two-minute closing statement.
We've been over some things. Obviously, my opponent and I are not going to agree on anything. My record speaks for itself. The budget went down. Crime has gone down. And we're the safest community in the metro area. We're positioning ourselves technologically, physically. We know where our next precincts are going in. And we do have a south precinct, by the way. It operates just exactly the same way it did before. So moving forward, we're positioned and ready to go. Those of you that are here tonight that aren't going to vote for me, I wish you'd change your mind. The ones that are, I appreciate you being here, I appreciate your support, and thank you for being here tonight.
Ron, 2 minutes.
Well, we all thought this might be a little contentious, but you know, the fact is, it's time for truth to come out, and it's time for people to take a side on who they believe. My dad and my grandma always taught me the most important thing I had was honor. Nobody can take that from you. Only you can give it away. Now, I'm not going to make promises I can't keep. Fact of the matter is, Duane has. I'll be honest. I'll tell you what's going on in your community. And if I make a mistake, if I mess up, if I lose our accreditation, I'll tell you I did it. I'll apologize for it, I'll ask for your forgiveness, and I'll tell you what we're gonna do so it doesn't happen again. I'll use the experience and education I've worked long and hard for to help make our community a safer place. I'll keep you better informed, I'll lead an agency that people wanna stay at, and I'll help recruit some of the best officers we've ever had here. And we make no mistake, we have some fantastic deputy sheriffs who still work for this agency. I love and respect every one of them. I've lived here nearly my whole life. My service here was built on my honor and my integrity of who I am. And if you elect me as your sheriff, that's not going to change. Whatever job title I have, and I have a job now, and whatever I need to do, it's not going to change who I am. I'm Ron Freeman. I'm the same man I've always been. And I'm here tonight to ask you to help me become the next sheriff of Forsyth County. Thank you.
Thank you all for coming out tonight. Let's give these two gentlemen another round of applause. Let's also thank BJ Van Gundy for coming over and thank you all for coming out and hopefully you enjoyed the debate series. Stick around, there's candidates in the room for both County Commission and Board of Ed, as well as the sheriffs are still here, coroners are still here. So please ask some questions if you'd like. Thank y'all.